Most of it.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, really?
Yeah, people do this really great bath.
The mother.
Yeah.
She tried to take on start like maybe early nursing home from now. And I asked the old people over there, and he would kind of say, it's kind of set a little bit of that.
Because she were. But she didn't always do that.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to Grace Lutheran Church. As we have been enjoying very beautiful weather lately, and we see all the fields and trees turning to green, so our liturgical colors turn to green as well, as we anticipate a season of growth, both in our fields, but also in our Christian life, as we continue our walk with our Lord, and learn from His Word and learn His teachings. So this is a very exciting season of the church year as we begin these Sundays following Pentecost, and we kind of march through, this year we're marching through the Gospel of Matthew. So we begin on that journey now, beginning today. I would just draw your attention, especially to the back side of your bulletin, that there are many events coming up. For those of you involved with church council, we'll be meeting after the service. We also have Men's Bible Breakfast is reconvening in person starting this Tuesday at Grace, as well as a Board of Elders meeting and a Board of Education meeting on Tuesday and Wednesday, respectively. And then the 1 Corinthians Bible study, that wraps up this Wednesday as well, if you've been coming to that on Zoom. I do welcome everyone who's participating with us online as well. Something else to keep on your radar. Next week, I'll be out of town for the PALS retreat, that continuing education a retreat that I have been doing ever since I got here. It's a three-year commitment, three times a year. So the second PALS retreat of this year is coming up. That'll be in Manawa, east of us a little ways. I'll be meeting with the pastor there, who lives in Manawa. Actually, he's a facilitator, so that's why it's there this time. But anyway, I will still be available during that time. If you need to get a hold of me for any reason, just via phone or anything like that, you can get a hold of me still. But just know that I won't be holding office hours on the 23rd through the 25th are the days that I'll be gone for that PALS retreat. We continue with our service now at this time. Our opening hymn is hymn number 727, On Eagle's Wings. And you actually hear that phrase, On Eagle's Wings, you'll hear that phrase in the Old Testament reading today, so that's why that was chosen. Order of service that we'll be following is the service of prayer and preaching, if you want to put a bookmark there on page 260. But we rise for our opening hymn number 727.
Thank you.
service of prayer and preaching on page 260 of your hymnal. This is the day which the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
From the rising of the sun to its setting.
The name of the Lord is to be praised.
Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere.
I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked.
Make me to know your ways, O Lord.
Teach me your paths.
Sanctify us in your truth.
Your word is truth.
From the rising of the sun to its setting,
the name of the Lord is to be praised. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The congregation may be seated as we sing the Old Testament canticle on page 261. Sunday after Pentecost is from Exodus chapter 19. The people of Israel set out from Rephidim and came to the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain while Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him out of the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words you shall speak to the people of Israel." So Moses came and called the elders of the people and said before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. All the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from Romans chapter 5. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned, for sin indeed was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not counted where there is no law, yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We rise in honor of the Holy Gospel, which this morning is taken from St. Matthew, the 9th and 10th chapters. Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." And he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are these: first, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother; James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother; Philip and Bartholomew; Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector; James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus; Simon the Cananean; and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, "Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and proclaim as you are going, saying, 'The kingdom of heaven is at hand.' Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You receive without pain, give without pay." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We continue with the responsory on page 263 of your hymnal. Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens.
Lord, we love the habitation of your house, and the place where your glory dwells.
Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house, and the place where your glory dwells.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house, and the place where your glory dwells.
We continue by reading the Catechism together on page 264, beginning with the Ten Commandments.
You shall have no other gods. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or
or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. We confess our Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We pray together the prayer our Lord taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The congregation may be seated as we continue with our hymn of the day, God Loved the World So That He Gave, hymn number 571.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ. Amen. The congregation may be seated. You know, back in my chemistry days at the University of Illinois, I remember being a teacher of chemistry there. You see, I was both a student taking chemistry classes myself, but also a teacher teaching chemistry classes for the grades that were below me, especially the incoming students there at the university. And in this endeavor of teaching the students, I had several colleagues, teachers who were teaching alongside with me. And I remember a certain conversation I had with one of my fellow teachers that really struck me and has stayed with me to this day. For we were talking about testing and the difficulty of testing sometimes. You know, some of those chemistry tests can be quite hard. And so at this point in our education, we had got to a point where we had been tested and approved ourselves to be teachers of chemistry to others. And yet, this fellow teacher of mine had admitted to me that he cheated on his tests and his chemistry tests in the past. And I was a little dumbstruck by this, you know, not sure exactly what to say, that he was admitting to cheating and that he was okay with cheating on his tests. Now, I think that most teachers here, and most teachers in general, would agree that this is wrong, that this is a breaking of the Ten Commandments, lying, dishonoring of authority, things like that. And so most teachers would obviously discourage cheating on tests and their students, and yet did my colleague not get the message? For he was giving a bad example himself to his students by saying it was okay to cheat, at least candidly admitting that to me. Now, in our gospel reading from Matthew chapter 9, it says that Jesus also was teaching. He was traveling about through the towns, teaching the people. And this is what it says, beginning at verse 35 of Matthew 9. And Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. So as Jesus was traveling about teaching and healing diseases and preaching that the kingdom of heaven has come near, he saw the people as being harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Like sheep without a shepherd. And this morning, Jesus is inviting us to have compassion on fellow sinners, to have compassion on fellow sinners because they do not have a shepherd. At least not a good shepherd. You see, there are many teachers out there in the day of Jesus and in our day as well. There are many teachers. But some of them are very bad, or they give a bad example. And so Jesus has a name for these as well. He doesn't call them shepherds, but he calls them thieves, robbers, and wolves. And so there are these bad teachers, these thieves, robbers, and wolves, who are out there. They want to teach you and have authority over you, but they have bad intentions for you. They want to gain power and control over you through their greed for gain. And so they are okay if you get addicted to vices and things like cheating, gambling, alcohol, pornography, gossip, anger. That's okay as long as they come away with their greedy gain, these thieves and robbers who would teach you for their own greedy gain. Now, I am well aware that we have a tendency to view people who wrong us, who sin against us, we have a tendency to view people as morally responsible agents. That is to say that when we are wronged, it's easy for us to come up with a list of all the reasons, this, and that, why the person was wrong, and why they shouldn't have sinned against us in that way, and why they have broken their own moral code, and things like that. So, and the Bible is clear. The Bible does say that we are morally responsible agents, and we will have to answer to God for our own doings, whether good or evil. It is true that we are morally responsible agents. So it is easy to condemn people who wrong us for their sin and to say this is why they were wrong. But it is also true, and Jesus would have us learn and understand this morning, that people are also helpless victims of bad teachers. People are also helpless victims of bad teachers. You know, maybe my colleague, that fellow teacher I had in chemistry, maybe he had a bad example of someone who taught him how to cheat. And so he was just following the bad example of one of his teachers. And so Jesus looks out on the people, he looks out on you and me, and he has compassion on us because we are like sheep without a shepherd. And so Jesus has compassion on us who are sheep without a shepherd. And we have many teachers, but many times they're teaching us the wrong thing, especially when they lead us to sin. And you know, the way that Jesus has compassion, it always starts this way in the church. Because Jesus starts by having compassion on us who are like sheep without a shepherd. Jesus comes to be our good shepherd. He has compassion on us, and he rescues us from the wolves, the thieves, the robbers that would harass us, that would have power and control and authority over us. He rescues and redeems us by his cross, by his death and resurrection. And when Jesus has compassion on us, he therefore creates a compassionate church. So our compassion has its root and has its beginning with Jesus' compassion. We see the same pattern in our Old Testament reading from Exodus chapter 19, for this is shortly after God has led the people of Israel out of Egypt. And all the mighty wonders and miracles he worked in Egypt to free them, the 10 plagues, the crossing of the Red Sea. And God reminds them that you were like people who were flying on eagle's wings. The eagle bore you up and flew you to freedom. And when you and I are riding on the back of an eagle, we're not contributing to that flight, right? It is the eagle who is flying for us, not us. And so God, he has compassion on his people, and so he redeems them and creates a compassionate people. Jesus has compassion on us. When he first gives us his grace and redeems and rescues us as those who were helpless victims, being harassed by the thieves and robbers and wolves who would lead us astray and take advantage of us. So our compassion is rooted in that compassion, that same compassion that Jesus has for us. Jesus is inviting us to have compassion on wayward sheep who do not have a shepherd. And so when you are wronged by someone, Jesus is inviting you to ask, not why they were wronged, but to ask maybe to have compassion on them. And that maybe the reason they're wronging you is because they have been misled and led astray by those thieves, wolves, robbers who would lead them astray. They are like sheep without a shepherd. And so Jesus, he has compassion on us when we were lost sheep. And he is inviting us to have that same compassion for others. And I know as we look around the world today, there is lots of confusion, there's violence, there's looting, there's sickness and disease and death. And so into this situation, Jesus sends us as those who are compassionate. Those who look on others, not just as someone whom we can condemn for their sin, but we look on others as lost sheep who need a shepherd. And so we have compassion on them. For after all, Jesus has compassion on helpless victims and wayward people. Jesus has compassion on you. And now the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ, the Good Shepherd. Amen. this time, we would normally continue by passing the offering plates, but just as a reminder, the offering plates are available for you at the entryway to the church when you come in or leave. So please drop off your offering there. Or you can always continue to mail it into the church during this time, either to the church address or to Betty and Larry. So just as a reminder for that, for offering. At this time, it is my pleasure to tell you a little bit more about a book distribution that the Board of Education has put together. So I invite Susan Brookjohn to come forward, as she's been one of the masterminds behind this.
Jill.
As well as Jill. That's right. And Jill, please come forward as well. Jill Giese. So in our gospel reading this morning, we heard about Jesus and how he has compassion on us, and that we should pray for laborers to be sent out into the harvest, for the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. And so we see Jesus already answering that prayer in Matthew chapters 9 and 10, where he sends out the 12 apostles, right? And we get the 12 apostles' names. So we should take a lesson from that even Jesus, the Son of God, he called together a group of people to help him with proclaiming the kingdom. And so in the church, where we are compassionate towards one another, one of the ways that we have compassion is that we help each other out. So the Board of Education has put together a whole collection of books to give out to our youth and the children of our congregation. And so we rejoice and we give thanks to the Board of Education for their hard work in putting this together and assembling these books. And as well, thank you to the Dual Parish for your generosity in supplying these books for our youth. We hope that these books can be, like I said, the start of a Christian library in your homes to help your children as they grow in their discipleship and their walk with their Lord. So we are a compassionate church that works together to make things like this happen. So I think what we'll do is we'll call forward the families individually to come and get their books. So I'll turn things over to you, Susan, if you'd like to say anything else.
I'll say something while Susan gathers books here. We had talked to Board of Education that every year we have some allotment of money to put toward our libraries for the adults and for the children, and the children's is downstairs. And my feeling personally was that we don't utilize these books enough. And of course, especially with children, I think some of the adults utilize the adults' library more. And we came up with the idea of, why don't we place these books in our homes and have, like Pastor said, the start of your own Christian library in your home. This time you'll find there will be a few more added things, because we have to get out the catechisms and a few books that we'll be using in the Sunday school classes. And this is our first time doing this, and Sue did an excellent job of trying to pick out all these different grade level things. And I think in the future we'll fine tune it a little, but hopefully your kids will take these home, interact with your child, don't just hand them the book, maybe sit down and read it with them. But Sue, you have somebody here?
Yeah, Barrett and Elise Passo, you wanna come forward? Because like this year, Elise is getting the whole set of this book, but from this year on, then, there you go. First grade will get part of the set, second grade will get part of the set, and this year she gets all of it because we didn't want her to just have a partial set. There you go.
Sure. Clingies.
George, this is yours, and then I'm going to give you Douglas and Andrews, okay?
Thank you.
You're welcome. Let's see, this would be yours, and this is yours, I believe. There you go. Shooties. Allison, or Madeline?
Madeline.
I don't know, sister. I think you got a foot taller this summer.
Okay, Walter, this is your book. And Madeline, that's yours. And then you can take Allison's book too, okay? All right. Girls, you want to come up? Megan, Tiana, whatever you need. Megan, will you stay, put yours over there and stay up here a minute? Daniel.
Sadie?
Sadie, can you come up?
You get to haul everything back with you. Sure, you can bring Mom along. She probably needs somebody to guide her up here. Come get some books.
Let's see, we have... Quite a sheet. You can take that away from Orban.
You can take this home, and part of them's for Weston and part of them's for you, but we'll let you have this whole stack. Can you handle it all?
Okay, thank you. You and Weston have
James Jacobson, his sister got her book when she was confirmed, but she did get a special book to give that to Grandpa for now.
Thank you.
Welcome. And the Board of Ed meets this week, and we are, of course, we have decided to not have Bible school, but we will be discussing what we're going to do about Sunday school. We will have Sunday school. We're just deciding what our class sizes look like, what our space looks like, so hopefully we could follow some social distancing guidelines. I guess my hope is if we find out that we need a couple extra people to help so we can divide our groups into smaller, I don't know, maybe we can even get a couple parents to come forward and, you know, try to commit for at least half the year and then maybe another parent commit for the other half of the year, just till we get through this first session of Sunday school for this coming year and just see how COVID does and how we do. It's definitely a new world out there for all of us. My first time back at church, I've been watching at home. I'm sure there's some people watching at home. I guess as far as technology goes, we're blessed that we can do that.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else here?
Anybody here who has children who didn't receive their stuff?
Yeah, I think it's a lot of grandkids. Okay. I don't know if you want to take Jason, the girls' books, or if you want me to get a hold of Mom.
We can take them.
You want to take them?
Sure.
Give them those. Otherwise, I'll get a hold of, like, Patterson's and Jarrett's and Claus and some of them. I do have for Stella and Wyatt Ruth, but I'll take care of getting them to them and different ones, so I will get the rest of these. And there are bags next door, too, that are labeled with Sunday school and craft materials and stuff and extra colored books we had that each family could pick up theirs to take home. We cleaned everything out downstairs, so we'll get it after church. Yeah, so that's good.
Yeah, and the goal was to give these out on the last day of Sunday school, but obviously didn't happen that way with the way the world events shaped up to be. But we do pray that these are a blessing to you and your homes and for your children. And like I said, this is for all of the youth of the congregation, not just the young Sunday school kids, but we have something even all the way up through high school for our youth. So spread the word, get the word out that you'll be able to pick these up if you didn't get them. My office hours will be certainly available for you to stop by and pick them up if your child did not get one of these books. Otherwise, just reach out to the office and we will get them distributed in a timely manner. We continue with the prayers of the church. Please rise. In our prayers this morning, we will especially be remembering the birth of Emmett Austin Kantner, who was born to Tom and Maddie on May 22nd. So we give thanks to the Lord for Emmett's birth, also the grandson of Susan Grochum, Emmett is. We give thanks to the Lord for Emmett. I will be concluding each prayer petition with "Let us pray to the Lord," to which the congregation responds, "Lord, have mercy." Let us pray. For the church and her witness of hope to the world, that in every city, village, and home across the globe, the voice of the Lord may be heard through the faithful preaching of the gospel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who labor in the fields of the Lord today, and for the Lord to raise up laborers for harvest fields, that their work may be blessed, and they may be protected and defended against the enemies of the kingdom, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our Synod, the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, and Matthew Harrison, our Synod President, for our dual parish and its leaders, and for the resources to accomplish what the Lord has given us to do, despite all obstacles and temptations, that united in the faith we may serve the Lord with joy. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who live under the flag of our nation, for those who govern in this country, and for the cause of peace and justice, that we may all be given grace and freedom to serve the Lord honorably and our neighbor in love, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and hungry, the homeless and the unemployed, and the oppressed, that the Lord would grant them mercy and that we may help to relieve their suffering and want, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the birth of Emmett Austin Kantner, we give you thanks, Lord. As you have added him to the human family, so also unite him to your holy church through the waters of holy baptism. By the gracious working of your Holy Spirit, help him to grow in your care and shepherding, that he may bring glory to you and serve others in your name. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick, that the Lord would grant them healing. For the wounded in spirit, that the Lord would make them whole. And for the grieving, that the Lord would comfort them, especially all affected by the ongoing pandemic and its effects. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who know the riches of the Lord's blessing, that they may cheerfully return to the Lord the tithes and offerings of a grateful heart, and give generously to the many agencies of the church working to help those in need. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the dying, that they may have peace at the last, and for our grateful remembrance of those who have died in Christ, that in the fullness of time, the Lord may bring us with them into his everlasting presence, where sin and death trouble no more. Lord, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O blessed Lord, through Moses you called a people to yourself, and from them you delivered up your own Son to be our Savior. By his suffering and death, he has redeemed us sinners from our sins, and by his resurrection he has released us from the fear of death. Help us to live as your own people, doing the good works for which we were created, and praying with confidence the requests of our hearts. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty, eternal God, the word of your apostles and prophets, in which you have proclaimed to us your saving will. Grant us faith to believe your promise, that we may receive eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We pray together on page 266 of your hymnal, the morning prayer. Page 266. We pray.
I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. And I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil. please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil soul may have no power over me. Amen.
Congregation may be seated as we sing the New Testament canticle on page 266 of your hymnal. Hymn number 594, we rise as we sing.